8:8, don't forget the Sabbath. Almost with this voice.
Don't forget the Sabbath. Don't forget the Sabbath. Don't forget the Sabbath. Come. Don't forget the Sabbath. The Lord of all has blessed. Oh, all the week, the brightest of all the week, the best.
See you.
Faithful, joyful be, I adore you. Number 12. Number 12.
Joyful, joyful we adore thee.
Thank you.
We are going to have a lot of prayer. We will kneel down and we will stand. Let us pray. Our God and our loving Father, we come before you, dear Lord. This day, the day of your rest, the day of the Sabbath, which you sanctified, O King of glory. Father, allow me, thank you for the blessings which you have bestowed upon us throughout the week. Father, today is the seventh day of the week we are holy Sabbath. We thank you, Lord, for protecting us, Father, making us be here today to worship you, O King of glory. Father, we thank you and we glorify you. Father, we know we are sinners. We come before you, O King of glory. We cry unto you that you may forgive our sins. Father, cleanse us with the blood of Jesus, O King of glory. Father, now I want to bring your servant before you, Pastor, who is your minister, as he is going to deliver your message unto us, O King of glory. May it be effect into our lives, Father. Father, bless us. We pray for the presence of your Holy Spirit to be among us as a King of glory. Father, let us be with you, and as we finish, Father, guide us. And it is in Jesus' name I pray and trust.
Amen. Amen.
Happy Sabbath once again.
Happy day.
Happy day.
I'm
calling upon the young adults to come and present an item. Please, and hurry up. Young adults, you are speaking, please.
Thank you.
life is offered unto you.
Happy Sabbath.
Happy day.
And happy day.
Happy Sabbath.
A warm welcome to all of you. It is a cold Friday evening, and it gladdens my heart that you are able to find yourself at the feet of Jesus. This weather reminds me of a story. A story that happened in one of the Adventist churches in South Africa. It is said that there was a granny. There was a granny, an old woman, who was a member of some English-speaking church in one of the capitals of South Africa. It is said that this granny would come to the church very early every Saturday. It was a habit. And she would sit at the same spot every Sabbath. That spot was her usual spot every other Sabbath. And this granny had the habit that whenever there was sweet music or powerful message preached from the pulpit, you would stand from behind and shout, "Hallelujah, Amen." She would shout from the top of her voice. That habit pleased some members of the church. But others were disgusted, others felt that she is being too noisy. Others loved her for that, but some others felt that she is too noisy and should not be shouting in church. Interestingly, part of the people who felt that she is too noisy was the church pastor. And one day when pastor was scheduled to preach in that church, she called the granny aside during the week and told her that, "Old woman, I will be preaching tomorrow, but I want us to agree that tomorrow you will not shout from the start of the sermon to the end." And this old lady looked at her pastor straight in his eyes and told him, "Man of God, it's not easy, but I'll try." The pastor went and bought some nice gifts, some pair of shoes, blue in color, and gave this woman and told her that, "I want to gift you these shoes because all my life I have not seen you wearing this type of shoes. So promise me that you will put them on tomorrow, but when I stand to preach, when you are tempted to shout, you will look at them and remember our deal." It is said that the next day the old woman came, sat at her usual place, nice shoes on her foot, and the sermon started. At some point, the pastor was moved by the Holy Spirit, and the man of God spoke so passionately about an area that touched this old woman. The old woman stood up and was almost shouting when she looked at the shoes and remembered the deal, and she sat again. Towards the end of the sermon, the old woman was inspired again. She felt touched. She stood up one more time and was about to shout "Hallelujah, Amen." She looked at her feet and saw the shoes and remembered the deal. Towards the end of the sermon, when pastor was almost making an appeal, this old woman felt so touched uniquely. This time round, before standing, she removed the shoes, placed them in some bag, then stood up. She threw the shoes back to the pastor in the pulpit. And the church was like, "What's happening? Who is throwing the preacher with the shoes?" And the old lady was heard shouting and telling pastor, "Pastor, shoes or no shoes, gifts or no gifts, favors or no favors, pastor, I will praise my God." Amen. There is a sense in which that spirit is needed in the church today. Men and women who will say, "Shoes or no shoes, comfort or no comfort, warmth or no warmth, shelter or no shelter, I will join the angelic host of heaven in welcoming the day of sacred pleasure." Amen. That is the faith that God is looking for in those who profess the Sabbath today. Tonight, our sermon title is "The Prayer of Jabez, the prayer of Jabez. That is our sermon title, the prayer of Jabez. I find no better prayer to recommend to this church than the prayer of Jabez. I find no better prayer to recommend to all who are following from far and near than the prayer of Jabez. This is a very life-changing prayer, and it is my plea and desire that by the end of this presentation we will desire to pray like Jabez prayed. This prayer is recorded in 1 Chronicles chapter 4. If you carry your Bibles, confirm with me. 1 Chronicles chapter 4. The prayer itself appears in verse 10. But I want us to read verse 9 as a background to this prayer. The prayer appears in the 10th verse of 1 Chronicles chapter 4, but I'm reading from verse 9. My Bible has these words. Now Jabez was more honorable than his brothers, and his mother called his name Jabez, saying, "Because I bore him in pain." And Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, "Oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me, and that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain." So God granted him what he requested. God granted him what he requested. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, this humble prayer offered by Jabez several years ago, we plead with you that this prayer will echo in our hearts today. That like Jabez, we will make this prayer to you and trust that you will grant that which we request. This is our prayer and plea in Jesus' name.
Amen.
You may deny every other thing in life, even if you are to live in denial. You may deny everything in life, but one thing you can never deny is the fact that we all have our stories. You can't deny that. Your story may not be good to hear, but it is your story anyway. Nobody does not have a past. You can't deny that. All of us belongs to some backgrounds. All of us belongs to some family. Your family may be broken, but that is your family anyway. It is a universal reality that no one can deny. And you know, God who designed life, designed it in such a way that nobody chooses where to come from. It is not within your powers to choose where to come from. You may choose who becomes your partner in marriage, but apparently you cannot choose who becomes your parents. Nobody chose who brought them into this life. God designed life in a way that you do not have the latitude to choose who becomes your parents. And so, you cannot deny that you belong to some family somewhere. Jabez, like many of us, heard his story. Jabez came from some background. He belonged to some family among the sons of Judah. He belonged to some family within the nation of Israel. And my Bible begins by saying that Jabez was more honorable than his brethren, implying that Jabez had brothers and perhaps sisters. Again, nobody chooses who becomes their brother or sister. Some of us have horrible brothers and sisters, but you do not have the latitude to choose who becomes your brother or sisters. Jabez had brothers and sisters. The Bible goes ahead to explain, to give us a glimpse of why Jabez was called Jabez. The Bible says that his mother named him Jabez because he was born in pain. This is a young man who came from a background that knew pain. Jabez knew the definition of pain. Jabez knew the definition of sorrow. Jabez came from a background that made him know what tears are. In fact, at the time of his birth, it is the pain, the hardship, and the struggle of his family that made him be named Jabez. So that throughout his life, his very name was a constant reminder of the circumstances surrounding his birth. Jabez came from a family where they would take a meal now and would not be sure where the next meal would come from. That was the family of Jabez. But I marvel at our God that there's no story God cannot change. I marvel at our God that there's no pain that God cannot bring to an end. What did Jabez do so that today his name appears in the Bible as more honorable? Where did this honor come from? How was Jabez able to navigate his background so that today his name is written, actually his name is immortalized into the pages of sacred history as more honorable? How was Jabez able to change his misfortunes into fortunes? What did this young man do? From that background, from that dirty past, from that spoiled and hopeless life, what was the secret of Jabez? What did he do differently that his other brothers were not able to do, that makes Jabez's life appears in the Bible as a model life? A few things change. Number one, Jabez was able to accept his story. He knew the meaning of his name. He looked at his family. He looked at his brothers and sisters. He looks at the condition of their home. It was not a very pleasing story, but it was his story anyway. So he accepted. I have said again and again, and I will not tire repeating, that you are not going to change a story you are denying. I will not tire accepting. No, I feel several years ago, when I was born, 8 months after I was born, I learned several years later after I was born, I learned that at 8 months I had lost my dad. And the death of my father brought in a state of being in me, a state called orphan. Now, as a result of that, life was never easy. And that is not a story I would love to hear, but it is my story anyway. It starts by accepting. Some of us have not accepted things that perhaps happened even more than 10 years ago. You are killing yourself, you are stagnating your progress by refusing to come out of your past. You are living in the past. So the first secret of Jabez, he accepted his story. I plead with you, sons and daughters of God, please accept. It may be painful, it may be sad, it may be dirty, it may be stinking, but it is your story. You've got to accept. If life has pushed you to the wall, and you are still a teenager, or are still a student, and you look back at home and you realize you have 2, 3, 4 kids, it's important to accept. If you have been through certain situations that have left you feeling wasted and wounded, single-handedly, you have to raise up a family of 3 or 4 without a life partner, it's important to accept. Jabez accepted his painful story. But he did not stop at that. Having accepted, Jabez purposed to change that story. He said that maybe God knows why I was born into this family. And so what my brothers were not able to do, I want to try. The tears that my sisters were not able to wipe, I don't want to take that direction. I want to make a difference. In other words, Jabez, although a young boy, but sort of he was able to appreciate that he was born to be a solution to some problem in their family. Some of us think that we were just born. Jabez appreciated that maybe there is something in my brother that has become the reason for the pain in this family. And so I, as Jabez, I want to take an opportunity to live differently. Do you have a brother or sister who has become the reason behind the family pain? And every other time, the family looks at him or her, their joys and happiness are gone. We were not born to add to the pain in our families. So Jabez chose to be different. But after purposing to change his story, how did he begin? My Bible tells me that after accepting his story and purposing to change it, the Bible says in verse 10 that and Jabez called on the God of Israel. He began with God. I submit to all of us that there can never be sustainable success if God is not in the picture. It's not possible. You can never make any significant difference if you keep God out of the picture. I have known men and women who are extremely brilliant, gifted. Men and women who are the stars in their institutions and schools. But they chose to keep God away from their lives. God was in the periphery. They could have changed their stories. They could have been the beacons of hope in their families. But they chose to give God their back. I can tell you that such people did not end well. Anytime you become reckless with your life, anytime you refuse to mind your morals, it doesn't matter how much salary you earn, it doesn't matter what title you hold, in a matter of days, you are becoming the next big disappointment to your people. There is no sustainable success, I tell you, when you keep God out of the picture. There are things money cannot buy. There are things you can't walk into a supermarket and get them on the shelf. And such things like peace, integrity, morality, good behavior, Christian values, those are the things that makes life celebratable. Those are the things that gives or brings a difference. Those are the things that brings honor to a family. I plead with all of us, be honest with your background. Identify one thing that is missing in that background and stand in the gap. Some of us come from very superstitious families. Some of us come from families where nearly everybody is addicted in some sort. Are you going to be the beacon of hope like Jabez? So Jabez began with God. And after beginning with God, my Bible tells me that Jabez told God to bless him indeed and enlarge his territory. He also told God that your hand would be with me and that you would keep me from evil. What a prayer. This is a young man who was able to realize that he was living in a society of evil. Jabez was able to understand the signs of the times. He knew that evil surrounded him left, right, and center. And so he was conscious of the kind of society in which he was living. Let me tell you, we live in a society where sweet is called bitter and bitter is called sweet. Ours is a society where your tears are my joy. We live in a society where your downfall, if you were to fall today, there would be celebration in your neighborhood back in the village. Not everybody is happy with your achievements. It's important to know the kind of society in which we operate. Walk to the courts of law and file divorce papers. There will be celebration in other quarters. Get into the bar, pick a wine bottle, let news reach some people that you no longer go to church, the son of so-and-so is in the city, but has gotten into addiction. Others will celebrate that news. That is the society in which we operate. Beware that this world can celebrate you when you fall more than when you decide to make a difference in your family. When you get into a company and you find 10, 20 people from your tribe or your home county living recklessly, it's very tempting naturally to forget your background and join the bandwagon of people who long lost focus. You find yourself sharing an office with people who had abandoned their God, people who are reckless with their families, people who have no regard and respect with their marriages, and you are tempted to get into that bandwagon. Beware! We live in a society of evil. No wonder Paul says in Ephesians chapter 5 verse 16 that redeem the time for the days are evil. Ours is a society that celebrates wickedness. People even brag about the number of marriages they have broken. People brag about the number of tears they have cost others. The number of people they have blackmailed and spoiled their careers. They speak those stories as though those are in their list of achievements. Ours is a society of reversed agenda. Jabez was conscious of that fact. So he told God, God, although I want to change my family story, although I want to bring a difference, Lord, please stretch your hand. Let that hand protect me from evil, that it may not cause me pain. My Bible finishes by saying, so God granted him what he requested. Tonight, is there someone here who is struggling to accept his story? You can't just get over it. Something has happened to you that has remained a wound in your heart every other year. Every time you remember it, your mind goes too far. Your mind wanders away. You do not even want to get back home. You are so bitter. Yours is a life of bitterness. You are unable to accept. You can't let it go. It has become an obstacle between you and your joy. Since it happened to you, your life has drastically changed. You no longer pick certain calls. You no longer make certain calls. You are a shadow of your former self. Heaven has sent me to plead with you to accept. Accept. If there's something you can do, please do it without minding what you have been through in the past. Some of us are comfortable in the cities, but out of bitterness, we have closed our eyes. You have a struggling brother, younger brother. You have closed your eyes. You do not want to listen to anything about your village. Please accept. For we will not be here forever. After accepting, involve God. Tell God, I am tired. I want you to help me change this direction. Help me change this story. be conscious of evil in the society. Not everybody has the right to speak into your life. God alone knows your true worth. So give God time and let God fix your life. May God bless us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I want us to pray. Do we have that prayer box around? Do we have that prayer box anywhere? So we can present those petitions to the Lord. Or maybe we will do that tomorrow. Let us stand and pray. Eternal Father, the prayer of Jabez is our model prayer tonight. Like Jabez, we all have our stories, our backgrounds. Like Jabez, some of our pasts are not so good to hear. Like Jabez, we are struggling to accept and let go. So Lord, tonight I lift this audience before Thee. This diverse audience, where Your people have had different experiences in the past. I plead with You, Eternal Father, give us the insight to accept. In any case, they are in the past. And Lord, help us to invite You tonight that You may take a pen, open a new chapter, and in that new chapter, rewrite our stories afresh. I plead with You, Eternal God, that You will protect us from harm and danger. Our families, our lives, our children, will You protect us? I pray, Holy Father, that this prayer will open our eyes and make us begin with You. If there be any in this audience who has struggled with a past experience, I plead with You that You heal that wound. This prayer is written in the Bible to demonstrate that we serve a God of possibilities. You granted the request of Jabez. You did it then. Please do it now in our lives. Bless us this Sabbath, and even as we prepare to join the rest, tomorrow we ask for Your grace to guide us. Take care of all of us, we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Moment, and we pray that He continually be with us.